God's grace, mercy, peace, brothers and sisters, are yours in God's sacrifice to you, his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Here's the thing about God. The things that make him awesome and wonderful are also the things that make him wholly terrifying. Think about this. God is everywhere. Everywhere. And that's awesome and it's wonderful. When I'm in a place or in a circumstance where I'm terrified, I'm uncomfortable, and I know I need someone, what a blessing it is and a comfort to know that God is there. But that truth is terrifying. When I find myself in a place where God probably wouldn't have me be, doing something God wouldn't have me do, saying something God wouldn't have me say. God knows everything. Everything. And that's awesome, and it's wonderful, and what a comfort. When I'm in a circumstance in my ministry, in my life, in my family, in any circumstance that I'm clueless, what a comfort it is to know that God knows exactly what is going on, that God knows exactly what is needed for that situation. But it's terrifying because God knows everything, and even what's going on here and here. The story before us gives us opportunity to think about this aspect of God when it relates to the way and the why of our giving. And we'll consider the widow this morning, and we ask that God would give our human flesh the warning that it needs and give our new man, the saint in us, the encouragement that we need. Jesus was at the temple, and it's maybe a little surprising that he would be there Tuesday of Holy Week, and this wasn't just any Holy Week. This was the week where he knew he was going to die. He fully understood that on Tuesday he was in the temple, and by Friday he would have been betrayed and wrongly accused and condemned and hung on the tree. But in the middle of it all, we read that he sat down and watched people put their offerings in the plate. He didn't just walk through the temple courts and glance over briefly and notice, it must be time for the offering. Mark says he sat down, which tells you that he had a purpose in sitting down, and it was, in the Greek, to spend some time observing the giving of the offerings. And what does that tell you about your Lord? He's very interested in what his people give. At a time where we would be saying, what you ought to be watching, Jesus, is your back. Because you got a disciple who's conspiring against you with your enemies. At a time like that, Jesus sits down and he watches. And what does he see? Mark tells us the first thing that he sees is that there are rich people who were bringing large offerings in. And maybe that's what we've come to expect, and it's proper and it's right. In fact, Jesus in Luke makes the comment. He says, to whom has been given much, much is expected. To whom has been entrusted much, much more is expected. And so in keeping with that principle, those who had tremendous amounts of wealth were coming and giving large donations. And we would say that's right. That's to be expected. That's how things work, right? But there's something in the Greek that tells you that this was being done in a different way, because as Jesus sat and observed this, what he noticed is that these rich people were going through and putting one large gift in, circling back to the end of the line, going through again and putting another large offering in, and then maybe even doing it more than that. It'd be like when the ushers collect their offerings and it's all said and done. You know, hey, Mr. Usher, I forgot this envelope. They were making a show of it. You see, what Jesus was watching was, sure, the activity of the giving of the offering, but he was watching much deeper, right to the heart of those who were giving the offering. And he saw the reason why many were putting money in the plate was a show to everyone else around. Jesus noticed, but he was looking here. Jesus saw something else, though. The poor widow, scraping together a couple of pennies, humbly walking to the collection box and putting in the bare minimum requirement of the temple tax. Jesus saw that. But again, he was looking here. And what he saw was worthy of commendation. It was worthy to call attention to for his disciples. It's worthy for us to consider this morning. Jesus made an outlandish statement on the surface. What do you think the disciples thought when Jesus said this? Poor widow who put in 2 cents, put in much more than all these rich people with all of their dollars. You see, those who were putting large amounts of money in were putting it in out of their wealth, and they really weren't sacrificing or giving all that much when you think about it. It's kind of like having a big piece of cake and scraping some frosting off the cake and giving the frosting. Well, you still have a nice piece of cake and some frosting left. Poor widow didn't even have any cake, much less frosting. He gave her milk money. Everything he had to live on. The amount was small, but the sacrifice of her heart was complete. And Jesus says, that is giving. Brothers and sisters, when's the last time that our trust and our confidence in our Lord's ability to provide, in his ability to give us everything we need at every stage of our life, when is the last time that the trust and the faith that we have in our Father has been so complete that we give at all sacrificially? A couple of things I just want you to think about practically to relate to this. We don't have a problem giving every month hundreds of dollars, maybe even thousands of dollars, to outfits like, I use Vanguard, Fidelity, any other brokerage or financial planner that you might be out there. We don't have any problem handing over even thousands of dollars to them, trusting that they will put it to use well, and in fact, we'll have something when we retire because of it. No problem. And the funny thing about it is the ones that we trust with all of this money actually go out of their way to tell us that you really shouldn't trust them all that much. Because past performance is what? No guarantee of future results. We trust them sometimes more than we trust the one who has guaranteed our eternal future. And we show it in the way that we offer. The other thing is this. None of us would say it takes a great act of faith to pay an electric bill. write out a check to We Energy every month. Mine's about $230 to $240 a month on average here the last couple of years. None of us would say that you have a faith that can move mountains simply because you can write a check out to your gym membership or maybe to pay the credit card bill after the month when you went on a nice vacation. None of us would say that's a great act of faith, but how often do these things that are not acts of faith far surpass the money that we return to our Lord in offering? God has blessed us richly, brothers and sisters, richly. The life and the death and the resurrection of his Son is enough. And he's thrown so much frosting on our cake, it's literally ridiculous. Mark ends the story the way he often ends some of his stories. He writes them, and they're really succinct, and they're short, and they're right to the point, and then all of a sudden, poof, it's gone. And it leaves you scratching your head oftentimes asking a question, and the question here is the obvious one. Jesus ends the story. She gave everything, all she had to live on, gone. Well, naturally, there's a question. Whatever happened to her? Having given all of the resources she had to live on, did she worship that week and then end up in an alley in Jerusalem somewhere, starving to death? I think we know the answer. I don't know what happened to her exactly. But I know the one who watched her, who showed such interest in her that day. He would show another particular interest to another widow later on that week, on Friday, pinned to the cross as he looked down on his mother, suffering hell itself. He took care of all of the rest of the worldly needs he would have in her life when he committed to her to his beloved disciple, John. Our giving is not a threat to our physical existence, brothers and sisters. Jesus has loved us so much to stretch his arms out and die, to have nails pinned through his hands that our hands might lose a death grip that we have on our money and the things of this world that he's blessed us with. May the one who has been our sacrifice, who now reigns alive from the grave at God's right hand, may he inspire us, equip us, challenge us, move us, open our hands, and give sacrificially. Amen.